For the members of the committee, this, the hearing is going to start in 2 minutes. Please return to the chambers. Okay, we're going to have to begin. Okay, we are going to begin, and the next bill we're going to hear is SB2X5 by Senator Simidian. Thank you, Senator, for bringing us a second very important bill to address the data issues necessary for the Race to the Top program. Welcome, and please proceed.
Third and final time. Thank you, Madam Chair and members. This measure develops a process by July 1st of next year for reviewing and responding to requests for individual pupil data records that are housed in our California Longitudinal Pupil Achievement Data System, more commonly referred to as CALPADS. It also works towards developing the larger preschool through 20 comprehensive longitudinal data system and providing stakeholder access. I think you know, Madam Chair, and the staff analysis, by the way, was very thorough, did a great job of laying this out. Federal guidelines for Race to the Top specifically require stakeholder access. It's one of the missing parts of our existing CALPADS system. This bill is actually similar to SB 1425 Steinberg, which cleared this committee but was vetoed last year. However, the conditions that led to the veto message are no longer applicable since the federal guidelines are now in place.
Excuse me, Senator. Can we get people to sit down and settle down and give Mr. Senator Simidian the attention to his bill, please? Thank you. Please continue.
Thank you. After watching you, I'm hoping they're not paying attention, Madam Chair. Before I introduce the witnesses, I wanted to indicate that willingness to accept the amendments that are proposed in the committee analysis. There are two of them. I believe they are on page 8 of the analysis. Happy to accept those as author's amendments. My understanding is that you'd like us to take those in appropriations if we're fortunate enough to get out of your committee today. Happy to do that. We have witnesses who are in support. Brad Strong from Children Now and Linda Gallagher from the Bay Area Council. But more broadly, I'm just delighted we have no opposition, bipartisan support in the Senate, and good support from not only social justice groups and education groups like the California PTA, who may not still be with us, they had to leave, I think, but we also have good support from folks like the Bay Area Council, Business Organization, LA Chamber of Commerce, and law enforcement as well. It's really a nice cross-section. Witnesses in support, as I say, start with Brad Strong and then go to Linda Gallagher.
Thank you, Senator. Please proceed.
Thank you. Brad Strong with Children Now. In our Race to the Top application, we are specifically judged and scored based on our plan to provide access to and use of data. Today, we have a statewide data system, but researchers will not have access to comprehensive data sets of student-level data without this bill. And our Race to the Top application will be adversely impacted by that. This bill proposes critical authority to release student-level data from our statewide data system. It does not restrict access to non-personally identifiable data to non-researchers and the general public. This is really focused on how do we ensure access to student-level data. I think it's important to note that it actually saves money from the costly scrubbing that would need to occur if researchers were to request data and the department needed to go through and scrub the data, and they ultimately wouldn't even have the comprehensive data sets that they would need for the analysis. And it also ensures compliance with the America Competes Act, which is one of the assurances that we had agreed to in order to get the federal state fiscal stabilization dollars, and that's in its connection to pre-K through higher ed. Thank you.
Next witness.
Hi, I'm Linda Gallagher, the Vice President of Education for the Bay Area Council, and I'm here to speak on behalf of the business community, the large employers that the Bay Area Council represents, and our strong support, as usual, for Senator Simidian's data system bills. We just believe in the moving forward as fast as possible as the state can to a comprehensive longitudinal data system. I'd also like to give the support of the REAL Coalition, the Regional Economic Association leaders, for this bill.
Thank you. Next.
Association of California School Administrators, Sherry Griffith. We don't have an official letter in, but we are officially in support. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Barandes with the Education Trust West. We're here in support of this bill. We believe that the information in CalPADS needs to be as accessible as possible to researchers so they can inform what policymakers make decisions upon around education in California. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Next.
On behalf of the University of California, we're in support of the increased data sharing and the longitudinal data. And thank you.
Thank you.
Erica Hoffman on behalf of the California School Boards Association, very much in support of both of this measure, both for the longitudinal issue, but also ensuring that it is good data, that is usable data that parents and school teachers and school board members can use to inform those educational decisions.
Thank you. Next.
Good afternoon. Chris Reif on behalf of State Superintendent of Public Instruction Jack O'Connell. Similarly, as ACSA, we had not provided a letter of support, but the Department of Education, the superintendent, has taken a support position on this measure and really wanted to thank the committee staff for working with us, as well as the senator for taking and addressing some of our concerns, and really appreciate the committee moving this forward. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Liz Guillen with Public Advocates. We're in strong support of this measure. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support?
Roberta Ferger, Pico, California, in support. Thank you.
Thank you.
Chelsea Rask, the Los Angeles Area Chamber of Commerce, as was stated earlier, in support with the business community. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition?
Madam Chair, members, Fred Jones, California Business Education Association. Again, once I have to reiterate, we do not have a position on this bill, but this is a data collection bill. I have had conversations with the author's office about including career technical education data from local education agencies in compliance to compete, America Compete Act. So we're trying to make it to where it's non-mandate, non-reimbursable mandate costs. So hopefully we can work that out. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Other witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, questions for members? Questions?
Move the bill.
Move the bill. Is there a second? Is there a second on Senator Smitty's bill? Mr. Ng. Moved by Mr. Soloria, seconded by Mr. Ng. Closing comments?
Appreciate the bipartisan support we've received, and as I said, the broad cross-section of support. Happy to work on some of these outstanding issues as the bill moves forward, but we're limited given our special session timeline and the race to the top. The one comment I did want to make, because it came from both Republicans and Democrats earlier, which I think is important, is yes, this is important in connection with race to the top, but even if there was no race to the top, this is work that has to be done. better that we get to it sooner rather than later, in my judgment. But ultimately, the utility of this data is that it allows people to see what works, what doesn't, what investments pay off, which ones not so much. Having rigorous third-party analysis of that data is an important part of making that work. I think that's why you see the broad cross-section. Respectfully ask for an aye vote.
Thank you, Senator. And this is a very, very important bill and really a centerpiece to our reform direction. And so I thank you for that very much. My staff is asking me to just make a very slight clarification, so it's on the public record that we made a slight change from the analysis with the language that allows districts access to data for pupils that intend or have been directed to transfer into the LEA but requires parental notification.
That's our understanding as well, and that was my intention, Madam Chair.
Correct. Thank you very much. Was there a question? Mr. Garrick.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to ask a question. I apologize for my delay in responding to your earlier request.
Yeah, I know. The Senator just did close.
just a quick question. I'll make it a two-part A and B. why are we limiting it to only nonprofits and not anyone that would want to be able to access, being a supporter of CalPADS and the concepts and for the past 3 years? I think it's something that needs to get underway. It's overdue. Both of us agree on that.
We're talking two responses, if I may, to that question. We're talking here about how do we balance the legitimate need and desire of folks to use this information, to analyze it, as I said earlier, to have independent third parties step in and say, what's happening here? That's an important goal. At the same time, we want to protect the privacy rights of these individual students and their families, and privacy, of course, is a fundamental constitutional right enumerated by the California Constitution. The question is, how do you do that? And how do you strike the right balance? There's already a process in place, and what we've done is said, let's build onto that existing process, and we are actually, by this measure, Assemblymember, expanding the eligible folks who would be able to participate from not just educational nonprofits, but any nonprofits. Now, that's a leap of faith. We think we can make it work with the rigorous criteria that are in the bill. But we want to keep that balance between privacy and access. And we think we've struck it, and I think the support you saw here indicates that we've struck a pretty good balance in terms of that. It may be that 2 years or 5 years or 10 years down the road, folks will come back and say, you know what, we can provide access to even more. But if parents, for example, were interested, they could work through their local PTA, which is, of course, a bona fide nonprofit. If a private sector organization was in partnership with, say, the University of California, they could step forward. But I do think when we start to get to information where we are worried about protecting the personal privacy of individual students and their families, we need to exercise some care. I have taken that leap of faith forward and said all nonprofits, not just educational nonprofits, but I think at this point that's as far as it would be wise to go.
Thank you for your response on that issue. I agree with you as it relates to the privacy data and the importance of that. My concern is just trying not to limit it too much. I appreciate the expansion that you're engaging in here. The other B part was as it relates to career technical education and the collection of that data. I would encourage you to consider that, please. It's very important. I think you were patient, very patient, in listening to the last presentation and my points and concern regarding career technical education and the importance of gathering data as it relates to that is, I think, fundamental to our future success.
If I may, through the chair, I also heard you say, Assemblymember, though, that you had concerns about what we mandated on our local districts. This issue did come to us a while back, but it came to us in the form of a mandate, which was why I resisted, both because that had cost implications, which in this particular year made it a non-starter, but even beyond that, in terms of the concerns that I think you and I share about how much we're going to tell local folks how they ought to do, what they ought to do, so on and so forth, that made it, I thought, ill-advised. We have just today, literally earlier during the hearing, been handed some new language which attempts to clarify that career and tech would be included, which certainly it's our expectation is that it would be, in a way that does not generate a mandate. Happy to take a look at it, but not sure what your own Assembly Appropriations Committee will or won't allow us to do as we go forward. But my sincere commitment to you, it's my expectation that career and tech would be included. It's part of the you know, K through 12, pre-K through 20 expectation. And we'll take a look at the language. As I said, it's only been given to us earlier today.
Thank you, Senator, for your response, and thank you, Madam Chair, for the ability to ask those two questions.
Thank you, Mr. Garrick. And with that, we have a motion from Mr. Solorio and a second by Mr. Ng. Again, thank you, Senator. And will the Secretary call the roll?
Brownlee?
Aye.
Brownlee, aye. Nastandi?
Aye.
Nastandi, aye. Amiano?
Aye.
Amiano, aye. Arambula?
Aye.
Arambula, aye. Buchanan?
Aye.
Buchanan, aye. Fuentes? Chesbro, aye. Ng?
Aye.
Ng, aye. Gaines?
Aye.
Gaines, aye. Garrick?
Abstain.
Garrick, abstain. Hall? Logue? No. Bonnie Lowenthal? Miller? John Perez?
Aye.
Perez, aye. Solorio?
Aye.
Solorio, aye. Torlakson? Torlakson, aye. 3, 6, 8, 11.
That's 11 votes. Your bill is out.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
And let me just say it is due pass to appropriations. Thank you.
Thank you.
So, next, Senator Romero, SB 1. Welcome, and I apologize for the late hour. It's just important bills, and it's hard to control all of the public comment and so forth. But we are happy to have you here and welcome you to our committee, and please begin.
Thank you so much, Madam Chair. And, you know, maybe it's somewhat symbolism. You're right, it is a late hour. Maybe it's just simply a late hour in America for us to really take a look at the fundamental need for education reform. So let's. I always appreciate the symbolism. But I want to thank you. I want to thank the committee members. I know it's been a long day for many of you. And even more so, it's been a long road in getting here today. But I am very proud to be here at this moment to present Senate Bill 1. This is a bold measure which answers the call of President Obama, of Secretary Duncan, who issued a challenge to every state in the nation to race to the top. On August 20th, the governor called an extraordinary session for us to answer this call. And a week later, of course, we did introduce Senate Bill 1. This bill has moved out of the Senate on a bipartisan basis. And I look forward to this bill being heard, debated, discussed, and moved forward as well out of this committee and on to the next chapter. This bill will ensure that California is not only eligible, that's not enough to be eligible. We are wanting to be competitive in this race to the top. The top matters, and the race takes the next chapter here in this committee room today. I believe that today is the day we can stand and deliver for California's students and their parents. And we do this by real change, by being bold, by taking on and answering the call that President Obama has issued to every state in the nation. We do this in Senate Bill 1 by looking at real change in public education with reforms that are related to a number of issues. To standards and assessments, to the use of data to improve teaching and learning, to lifting the caps on charter schools in California, to ensuring that every child in our school has access to an effective teacher and an effective school leader. We also renew our focus on math and science to ensure that our kids are ready for the global economy. And of course, we know that in this bill as well, that we will not move to the top if we fail the toughest assignment of all, and that is turning around the chronically lowest performing schools in California. Many have said race to the top, it's a one-time thing. It's all about the money, and it's not that much. Make no doubt about it. Race to the top is not just about the money. This is about a vision statement. This is about setting forth a template for how we envision the possibilities for public education. And so when we take a look at this, I would argue we need that money But it is not just about the money. And even still, we know that the final rules that we'll be setting forth as we go forward will bring in what has been put forth in these guidelines and regs that have been set forth as we speak. So let me talk a little bit about Senate Bill 1 and the overarching platform from which we proceed. We believe that Race to the Top, it's about equality, it's about opportunity, it's about ensuring that every child from all backgrounds, affluent and high poverty, in every neighborhood has access to a quality education. I look at it and I believe this is a civil rights issue. You know, it's interesting. I was looking at the time frame, and Race to the Top application is due on January 19th. Remember the date, January 19th. That is actually the birthday Dr. Martin Luther King, and it will be just one day after the nation in California. We're going to be on holiday that day. We are going to go home. Maybe we'll ride in a parade. We will say we have a dream. The next day, the application is due. So I am asking us to do the right thing today. If we're going to honor the legacy of Dr. Martin Luther King, then let's make sure that we do so in a way that puts our children first. We know that education is what makes us equal. It's what gets us to that mountaintop. And so I'm going to look forward to celebrating in January. And really, I think the birthday of Dr. Martin Luther King will not just be an act of symbolism. We will have something to deliver for the kids and the parents of California. I walk around with this scroll. I think probably some of you have seen me with it. And it looks like a diploma. And one day, it will be a diploma. I believe in symbolism. But actually, sadly, this is not a diploma today. It's actually a list from the California Department of Education. On this list, the names of 571 schools in the Golden State. Maybe you might take a look at it. I know one of my former schools is on this list. And this school is a list that shows the number of schools, 571, schools that have failed to meet their academic targets, not for 1 year, not 2 years, not 3 years, not 4 years, not 5 years, not 6 years, for at least 7 years in a row. Some of them, 10 years, an entire decade. We're going to talk about math and numbers. At least 7 years. And if you take a look at that list, 7 years, that's almost two cohorts, an entire generation of kids in a high school. 7 years and counting. Talk about a 7-year itch. If we do a breakdown by ethnicity of this list of students that are enrolled in the persistently lowest performing schools in California, make no doubt about it, it is a civil rights issue, because 86% of the kids on this list are either African American or Latino. 86%. And we're going to be celebrating Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday once again. Literally, millions and millions of California children have been left behind over the last 2 and 3 decades. And from the standpoint of public finances, the cost of persistence failure, the cost of persistent failure, it's not just about what we spend on schools, but it's also what we spend on welfare, on jails, on building prisons, on victimization. We all know that the California Dropout Research Project, they recently reported that each cohort of California dropouts, it cost the state of California $46 billion over their lifetime. That's a cost. That's a cost. And we know that California children and their families are suffering. We cannot wait. We should not wait. We must not wait for another decade to come before we finally have the courage and the conviction to truly turn these schools around. I think the beauty and the boldness of SB 1 is really its simplicity. It basically says that change is no longer voluntary. It's mandatory. It's about time. Let's just do it. I want to thank the committee for the analysis of Senate Bill 1. I did read it when I received it yesterday. I did notice that there's not one recommended amendment to the bill, so that could mean a number of things. Maybe you say, let's go ahead and move it out as is. I do, though, and I want to offer some specific language to address some of the concerns, and we'll ask the sergeants to pass this out, to move it out either here in this committee or to wait to take a look at it in appropriations. But it deals with technical questions. Some of them are that are raised in the analysis. I do want to acknowledge that I saw the very long list of concerns. Some of these, I believe, we can resolve, absolutely. With further discussion, we talk about moving bills along, a work in progress, and I look forward to continuing to have that dialogue and debate. I do think, however, that on that list of concerns, there are many items that, quite frankly, I don't believe we should put into statute, that do not belong in the bill. Some of those concerns in the analysis are already addressed in current law. Some of the concerns are addressed by the state's Race to the Top application and the MOUs themselves that will be signed by the participating LEAs. And so we don't need to put them into a bill. I want to remind us that we are not writing the application in the bill. Senate Bill 1, or for that matter, AB 8, that's not the application. In a sense, it's sort of the trigger that enables us to be eligible and competitive. So there are some of the concerns that we believe are best left to the application and the MOU itself. And I'd like to indicate that as soon as I open on this bill, I want to turn, of course, to our Education Undersecretary, Kathy Gaither, who will address many of those specifics in terms of what's in current law, what might be in the application, what might we might just fundamentally disagree on as well. But I do want to, in the time that I have, is to address at least a few of these issues, some specific points. And we can walk through the policy issues. There's a lot that there. It merits additional conversation as we move forward. But I think, to me, the real heart and soul of Senate Bill 1 is the focus on what Secretary Duncan has said, the toughest assignment, the one that we walk away from, the one that we look away from. And that deals with this list right here that I have been walking with since August when the special session was called. Secretary Duncan calls the turnarounds the toughest assignment because it's so easy to pass the buck. But he also said that we can no longer turn the cheek any longer on the turnaround schools. If we are going to be internationally competitive, we cannot leave hundreds of thousands and millions of California students over the years in the basically the hole of failing schools. And I don't think I need to remind you that California leads the nation today. Unfortunately, we lead the nation in dropouts. We have an opportunity to turn that around. Senate Bill 1 boldly establishes a plan for turning around the bottom 5% of California's chronically lowest achieving schools. Some of these include charter schools. They're on the list as well. The bill requires the State Board of Education and the Superintendent of Public Instruction to jointly to identify the lowest achieving, the lowest performing 5% of the persistently lowest performing schools in California and to make them subject to one of the four turnaround strategies chosen at the local level with public input. We know already that the state right now under federal law has actions that we can deal with these failing schools. But let's be honest. We know that Sacramento, quite frankly, too often has taken the path of least resistance. Let's put that out on the table. Sacramento too often has taken the path of least resistance when it comes to restructuring and turning around our failing schools. For about 90% of schools subject to action under NCLB, California typically chooses the other option. I mean, 90%. Let's be honest. That option, it's a loophole. It allows us to check the box and said, we tried something, and then to turn around and find year after year after year after year for at least 7 years and as long as 10, we come back really realizing that Sacramento has failed to act. We tinker. We talk. We are calling in Senate Bill 1 not to date and not to say, because all we do is wait. And so we are urging us to take action today. We know that oftentimes, if you look at this list, oftentimes we think we're paying homage to our civil rights leaders. We name schools after them. We've got King schools and Chavez schools and Rosa Parks schools. It's not to name a school after a civil rights leader. It's to do the right thing. And that's what we're asking us to do today. So this bill says it's not about rearranging the chairs. It's not about tinkering. It is about, yes, wading into the controversy. Because unless we're willing to be bold and to take on the controversy firsthand, we will come back in the next legislative session and come back with an even longer list of schools on this list. We have an opportunity today. Let me just focus on a couple of points of controversy in this bill. The first one, of course, is open enrollment. Open enrollment. Senate Bill 1 authorizes open enrollment for students who have been stuck in schools that have been identified as persistently low-performing, failing schools. Remember that scroll that I showed you? Simply, this controversial portion, open enrollment, says parents have a choice. Parents have a choice in public education to fight for their kids. Let me ask you, if you're a parent and you had a child in a school that had been on the list for at least 7 years, do you think you'd be on the front line saying, I'm going to fight for my kid? I'll tell you, my mother had a sixth grade education, but she was smart enough to know that education is what would make her daughter equal. We have zip code education in California today. Depending on geography, it's destiny. You live in this neighborhood, high poverty, high crime, schools that don't perform, there's no way out. We believe in public education. We're going to fight for public education. It's what makes us equal. Open enrollment simply says parents, the moms of California, just like my mother with a sixth grade education, had the smarts to know she was going to fight to make sure her daughter and all of her children would be educated. What's the controversy over open enrollment? If we actually take a look at it, we did it with community colleges 2 decades ago. And today, we can enroll in any community college of our choice. I believe in choice. I believe in a public option in public education. That's the controversy over open enrollment. But I believe, as a parent, if we expect responsibility from parents, then let's give them the rights, and let's not be afraid. That segues into the second controversial issue in this bill, the parent trigger. Okay, that's the second one. What does that mean? Essentially, it just says we empower parents to do the right thing for their kid. It basically allows parents to petition their government, to sign a petition, to engage in the most democratic, with a small d, the most democratic act, to sign a petition, to petition their school leaders to say, we want this school to turn around and to meet the needs of our children. We don't want to be on this list for another 7 years. That's the parent trigger. I believe in power to the people. I believe in giving parents power. I believe that parents who understand that education is what makes our kids equal will do the right thing. And it doesn't guarantee that the schools turn around. You know what the parent trigger does? It just gives them a chance. It gives the parents a chance to organize, to petition their government, to sign their John Hancock to a piece of paper, to say, my child needs a quality education. And as a mom, I'm going to stand up for my kid. I don't understand the controversy. I don't understand the fear. I do understand the need. And I'd like to acknowledge that when I was on the plane this morning, I ran into a number of moms on the plane flying up here, and I think you're going to see some of them testifying today. And I'd just like to stop and thank them. You're going to hear from the vice president of the L.A. School Board, Yoli Flores. I'm so proud that she's here today. She's going to tell you that when she ran a resolution in L.A. Unified District, the largest district in California, a school choice resolution in public education that gave parent rights, there were some 2,000 parents on the streets of downtown L.A. rallying in support of her bill. You know, we often hear parents don't care. Parents do care. Moms in California care. And all this parent trigger says is, you know what? We hear you. We respect you. Because make no doubt about it, we are not going to build any schools in California if it's the parents who pay the bills. It's the parents who pay the bills to keep the lights on in the schools. All the parent trigger says is let's respect our parents and give them a chance to petition their government. I don't understand the controversy. So I'm going to close there. I know there's many issues for dialogue, debate, discussion. I'm going to tell you I'm very proud to be here today, and I look forward to a strong dialogue. We can do this together. This is not a thing about pitting houses against each other. There is room for all of us. All boats can rise together as we race to the top together. But we are not going to get to the top if this list continues. We are not going to get to the top if we lock out and are afraid of our parents and their rights to march on us if need be. So I'm going to, at this moment, then turn to the undersecretary. She will walk through the technical parts about it. But I'm going to say we can talk about all the technicalese. Quite simply, this is a very simple bill. It simply says status quo is unacceptable. This is not about even reform or tinkering. This is about transforming public education so that every child in California will have the chance that this kid who came from the other side of the tracks with the mother with a sixth grade education had to stand before you today and say, I have not forgotten where I've come from. And there are too many kids on this list, just like me, with their moms, who are asking us, don't forget them either. So let me turn to our undersecretary and ask her if she can walk through the technical issues that I believe will address many of the questions that were raised in the analysis. Undersecretary?
Thank you, Senator. Thank you, committee. I think you already know that we're supporting this bill, so I won't say that. And this is not part of the support testimony. We looked at the questions that were raised.
I just want to get a clarification because the rules are 15 minutes of support and 15 minutes of opposition, and you just stated that you weren't part of the support testimony, but we have to include you in that.
Well, then with all due respect, if I may, Chair Brownlee, then I would ask her not to report at this time. Let's hear from the support witnesses, and she will be available afterwards for questions to walk through the technical issues of the.
Okay.
I just thought that there would be an opportunity to be able to delineate specific issues pertaining to the analysis, but we can hold on that and go through after the supporters have testified.
Great. So then we'll just ask for. Now we will start sort of that 15-minute segment and ask for witnesses in support of the senator's bill.
Lupita Cortez Alcala, on behalf of the State Superintendent of Public Instruction, Jack O'Connell. The superintendent is in support of SB 1. We've been a part of an unprecedented collaboration with the governor's office and the state board, and we believe that SB 1 does strike the right balance to make us competitive for race to the top, while still providing flexibility to allow us to design a state plan to ensure that we do whatever is necessary to improve student achievement and to close the achievement gap. At the end of the day, we agree with Assemblymember Arambla and Assemblymember Buchanan. We really would like both authors to work together collaboratively to reach a mutually agreeable measure to vote that out of committee because we really want to be competitive to race to the top. We want to speak with one voice, and we would think that both measures have really good aspects to them. However, you know, I just want to register our strong support for SB 1, but also encourage that collaboration and that dialogue and that discussion. And with that, we ask for your aye vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
My text said good morning. I'm Alice Huffman, the state president of the California NAACP. And as you know, we have 52 branches and 30 or 35 youth units. And so we're across the state, and we're in almost every school district. And the NAACP over the years has made education its number one priority. And we believe that education is a civil right. And we started demonstrating that with the 1954 Brown versus Board of Education that finally got our schools integrated. And at that time, we thought they would be equal and that all children would get an equal education if they could go to schools where the resources were present. Of course, we're here because obviously that didn't work. I have been in Sacramento for 33 years. We decided in the NAACP that we would look at the condition of public education. I want you to know that not only did I work for governor, but I also worked for the California Teachers Association for 13 years. I used to be their political director. And so I was here when we thought Serrano versus Priest was going to be the stabilizing financial bed for education. I was here when we blocked the vouchers. And we were told at the time when we went to our community, the African-American community and the Latino community, to stop vouchers from coming into California, that everybody was going to work to make sure that our kids got a quality education. Almost 30-some years ago. I was here when we did busing and when some senators and some assembly people either got elected or unelected because they took a stand on busing. And busing was going to be the great equalizer for our kids that were trapped. I have been here all through the movement, the, quote, reforms. You know there's been a reform almost every year. When I used to work for the teachers, we used to say there were so many reforms that we couldn't even figure out how to reform the statutes to do the reforms. That just kept coming. And so here's another opportunity. I was here when we did Prop 98. I was the lead staff person for the California Teachers Association when we did Prop 98. We thought Prop 98 was going to be the panacea. If we just had enough funds, we could do something about those poor performing schools. I have been a part of the establishment. I have known how to weigh bills down so that they go to a snail's pace instead of a race. I came in here this morning racing, and as I've listened, my heart has gotten slower and slower and slower. I have nieces and nephews who've gone through the public school system in California that can't read, that are ebonically endowed. Even I can't hire them in my private practice because somehow they come out of school, they don't speak English. Don't ask me why, but it happens right here in Sacramento. I applaud Margaret Fortune and the work they're doing. I'm here because we finally got tired. We said there's 3,000 low-performing schools. We're going to put something on the ballot. We found out we didn't have the resources to put something on the ballot, and if we put something on the ballot, we probably couldn't get it done because one-third of our school system is low-performing. Our public school system is low-performing. I felt like I was voting this morning as I sat here and listened to the discussion. I didn't know I came to have a discussion on charter schools. I just got to the point where I think it's all right to do a charter school if it's a public charter school, if it meets all the requirements. I thought I was going to be talking about how we race to the top, how we finally take what President Obama has given us, an opportunity to break the status quo, to break the establishment, not break the school systems. But all of you who've worked in this system know that if you use the institutional snail pace, I will have another generation of nieces and nephews, another generation of our children, that, yes, we have protected those who are the stakeholders. Well, let me tell you who my stakeholder is. My stakeholder are people in the community that don't have a voice up here. I finally got free. I don't belong to anybody. I don't work for anybody. I work for the NAACP. I don't represent any interest but the community. And that community, while I am primarily interested in blacks, there are brown children, there are white poor children, there are low-income or subgroups of the Asian community, and all of them will have to rise if California is going to rise to its call to keep being number one in the nation. I got with the governor in a strange kind of way because I went to him on these low-performance schools, and I said, we need help. Lo and behold, Mr. Obama decided about the same time that he was going to put out this call for us to do something innovative. I think they were smart. They were smart because we know, Chairwoman, that over the years, every time we take care of the institution, we fail our kids. I have been a party to it. I have been on it. And we know that we don't get the kind of change, the kind of dynamics that we need to move this public education system forward. I came to California because it had one of the best schools in the nation. High school dropout, I ended up going to Cal because we had a quality school system in California where that could happen. And so I'm not going to cry. I'm just going to tell you that if we miss this opportunity, we have really blown it one more time. If we can't take a simple bill and put the simple requirements in it and give people the flexibility to make the changes that we need made in California, we have blown it one more time. And you can call it whatever you want. You can call it great stakeholders, but if the stakeholders are not our kids and our communities that need you, that you came up here and promised to serve, you came up here and you promised to serve my community. I am fed up with getting the status quo. I am fed up with incremental progress. I am fed up with just having to look the other way while we protect everybody but the people that you vowed that you would protect when you came here. So I'm asking you to support SB X51. You put both of those bills out there and take the best of both, but I'm supporting this one. I walked the streets with the senator. We have been out explaining this. It does do the job, and I ask you today to do the job. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me ask Vice President.
Thank you, Madam Chair and members of the committee. I'm Yoli Flores. I'm Vice President of the Board of Education for the Los Angeles Unified School District. On behalf of the board and the superintendent, I am here to strongly support the legislature's efforts to ensure that California is highly competitive for Race to the Top. In early September, our Board of Education passed a resolution supporting SB 1. I thank Senator Romero's early and continued leadership on Race to the Top that not only positions California for desperately needed funding resources, but that also brings reform elements critically necessary to eliminate the shameful achievement gap that has plagued our educational system for far too long. This bill is bold, it's comprehensive, and it addresses the structural systemic failures. This opportunity comes at an extremely critical time for LA Unified and many, in fact, all of the school districts of California. Just yesterday, our board had to approve yet another round of budget cuts in excess of $450 million. This was in addition to the $1.5 billion in budget cuts that we have had to make over the past 18 months. So it is imperative that we do everything necessary as a state to leverage every possible dollar from the federal government. But I don't just care about the money. While the money is critically important, we also agree that Race to the Top should be more than simply securing additional funds. This competition needs to be about making meaningful reforms that benefit our students. In the last year, the LAUSD Board of Education has initiated a series of reforms that we believe demonstrate our position that the status quo of our educational system is no longer acceptable and that our students deserve better. These initial reforms put the needs of students and children first and make learning and teaching the center of gravity. They're also consistent with President Obama's call for change in Race to the Top. We are leading a teacher quality task force that is calling into question our practices around evaluation, tenure, seniority, and incentive pay. We're using data to drive instruction and learning, and using data as one of multiple measures of teacher and administrator performance. And finally, as a result of our recently passed public school choice resolution, we now have a plan and a process to turn around chronically underperforming schools, to increase models of academic excellence within the district, and to provide parents power, a voice, and greater choice in the educational options. The parent trigger that this bill speaks to is fundamental, because it will not be until parents have the power to demand better for their children that we believe that this system will ever change. We believe that Senate Bill 1 has the necessary bold elements that would not only make California strongly competitive, but will reform and transform public education. I understand firsthand the pressure to water down elements that are perhaps quote unquote controversial and that make keepers of the status quo feel uncomfortable. I know what that feels like. I know what it feels like to be threatened to be recalled. But when it gets tough, we need only to look at the data. And the data are not just numbers. They represent the lives of millions and millions of children who are and have been denied a future. Los Angeles alone has over 260 schools in PI3. We are no longer waiting for schools to be in PI5. Program improvement 3+ schools have already been failing for 5 years or more. We have third grade reading levels that put our country to shame. Only 1/3 of our third graders, poor and middle class, can read at grade level. And when you disaggregate that data for English learners, it's 9%. No wonder that 50% or more of our students are dropping out. At our well-known Garfield High School in East Los Angeles, only 5% of students are proficient in math. 5% of the entire school of 4,000 students are proficient in math. At Fremont in South LA, it's 1%. But these are not isolated cases. It is statewide. Our system is broken, and we are losing entire generations of children to poverty, to the streets, or to jails. This is what the establishment is protecting. Your actions can and must reverse these trends and bring back the educational system that once made California the envy of our nation. I challenge you to stand up to that status quo, to not be afraid, to deliver on the promise that every child deserves an education and a future. I urge you to act swiftly, boldly, and courageously. Thank you.
Thank you.
Andrew Governor, Governmental Advocates, on behalf of the Parent Revolution, in support of Senator Romero's bill, specifically because we support the parent trigger. I thought I'd turn it over to Ben Austin, Shirley Ford over there next to Ms. Huffman, and Representative K.W. Toulos to talk briefly about the parent experience, the parent trigger, and what their experience has been in Los Angeles.
We have about a minute before the 15 minutes is up.
I stand here to speak strongly in favor of SB 1, especially in favor of the parent trigger, which represents an entirely new paradigm for the way we think about education reform in America. It is only about giving parents power and trusting them to do right by their own children. It's about acknowledging that parents, above and beyond all other stakeholders in public education, are in the best position to make good decisions about what's good for their kids and for our collective future. Now, there have been some questions about the parent trigger. I want to answer them very quickly. All it is if half the parents at the existing school that is failing and half the parents of the feeder schools that feed into that school sign a petition, it would trigger one of the four remedies outlined in President Obama's race to the top. That's all it is. Right now, parents have no power if they're trapped in the attendance boundary of failing school. Under this provision, it would give parents power. Now, it's also important to keep in mind that every expert that we've talked to in Sacramento and in Washington believes that the parent trigger alone is worth hundreds of millions of race to the top dollars for the state of California, not only because it speaks to the specific provisions outlined in the parent engagement provision of race to the top, but also because it is bold. Because it is transformative, and it puts California back on the map as an education leader and an education innovator. So, and I also want to say that there have been questions about accountability. Parents want accountability, whether we're talking about charter schools or traditional public schools. But the best accountability is to give parents power and make the school system responsive to those parents. So we are living in a revolutionary moment. And these moments come and go more quickly than any of us can imagine. So I ask you to please stand up for children and do the right thing and seize this moment and transform public education for everybody in California. Thank you.
Thank you. And Senator, I've been very liberal with the time here. So now I need to ask for people to state their name and their organization and say that they're in support for the record. For additional people who want to speak in support for the senator's bill.
Madam Chair, I would just be remiss though if I didn't ask for some additional time. I don't know if
and all the bills, everybody's been kept to the 15 minutes of support. It seems as though it's a long day. Maybe the support went very, very quickly and concisely, but that's your time clock. I would respect that, but I ask if, you know, if we did literally keep to 15 minutes, I'll accept that, but I would ask for us to be valued.
The rules are 15, and we've gone 18. So.
I understand rules. I'm just asking, what was the pattern in practice?
No, I'm trying to be fair to all of the presenters today, and the rule has been 15 minutes on each side. So we will now have additional members who want to speak in support of the bill, and if they will state their name and their organization.
My name is Pastor K.W. Toulis, but my daughter, she doesn't call me Pastor. She calls me Dad. I do, however, stand here today in support of the Senator Bill. I missed a flight to stay here to testify in behalf of the parent trigger. So I just asked for just a few minutes.
I can't give you a few minutes, but
ultimately,
you make one last statement, and then we need to follow the rules.
I say that ultimately we can't afford to lose another generation of children, and so it's important that we do what we need to do, what is right for the people and for the parents and children. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And next witness in support.
My name is Shirley Ford, and I support Senator Romero's bill. And today, with some of you, I have felt like I felt when I was a little girl, where there were signs that said, colored only and white only water fountains and restrooms. For the ones of you that have really been in support for the parent trigger, I appreciate it greatly. But you know what? I look at parents every day that look like me in my community whose kids are dying, and they're asking me why. You know, I wish we could afford to bring them all up here so they could know why. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness in support.
Madam Chair, David DeLuz, President, CEO of the Greater Sacramento Urban League, and I'm here representing my two colleagues, Blair Taylor of the Los Angeles Urban League and Ray King of the San Diego Urban League. We stand in support of Senator Romero's bill, SB15X. We, too, have been here 4 or 5 hours for the opportunity to speak, but I will submit my comments in writing.
Next witness in support.
Dr. Daniel Walker, I represent Hardy Brown College Prep in support.
Thank you.
Rex Fortune, a 40-year public educator in California, including 20 years as school superintendent. I'm supportive of this bill, the parent provisions, and one thing not spoken about, and that's the career, the STEM alternative paths for people in the aerospace and the space industry become teachers in careers that the children that we're talking about need more preparation in mathematics and language in order to enter. And I am very proud to support the bill by Senator Romero.
Thank you. And please, if you'll state the name and the organization and your and.
Pardon me, I'm founder of the Fortune School of Education. We've graduated more than 1,000 public school teachers in the last 20 years of our existence.
Thank you for your service. Next.
Yes. My name is Francisca Dominguez, and I come from San Jose. I'm supporting charter schools, downtown college prep. I'm a part-time volunteer parent.
Okay. Let me be clear. Thank you for your testimony, but we're not receiving any more testimony now. I just need your name and your organization and that you're supporting the bill.
Leticia Ibarra, Dandan College Prep from San Jose, and I support the bill.
Thank you very much.
My name is Susan Neisonger, and I'm a parent and a teacher, and I support the bill.
Thank you.
My name is Harinder Pagani, and I'm a principal. You saw my students here earlier today, and we support the bill wholeheartedly.
Thank you very much.
Madam Chair, members, Rand Martin on behalf of the Charter Schools Association in strong support of the bill. Thank you.
Thank you.
Karen French, representing the University of California in support of this measure.
Thank you.
Brendan Tuig on behalf of EdVoice in support of the bill.
Thank you.
Nancy Lacoste, and I'm representing Long Beach Unified School District, Clovis Unified School District, and the Los Angeles County Office of Education in support.
Thank you.
Chelsea Rask with the Los Angeles Area Chamber of Commerce in support, if amended, per our letter we handed out earlier. Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
My name is Jody Retzloff. I'm the finance officer for Gateway Community Charters, and I am in support of the bill.
My name is Margaret Fortune. I'm president of the Fortune School of Education and a trustee of the California State University in support of the bill.
Thank you very much.
Omkar Bindra, on behalf of the Sikh community of Sacramento Valley, I request addition of measures which will ensure resumption of work.
Sir, I am sorry I have to interrupt you. And I appreciate your comments that you made on the earlier bill, and I hear your name and what you're speaking of, and you're in support of the bill. Thank you. Thank you very much. Any other members in support? People in opposition. Okay. So we'll give the opposition just a little bit more time to give some parity.
Good afternoon, Sherry Griffith. With the Association of California School Administrators, we appreciate the work of the Senator as well as the Assembly in this very important area. As you heard from one of our board members earlier today, superintendents are eager to participate in this process, and they want to enter into MOUs that are solid and clear and that are understandable to them at the local level. We feel a sense of urgency. We feel we're running out of time to do that because of the various pieces of legislation as well as a lack of a plan. So what we have done with these pieces of legislation is look at a side-by-side of the final guidelines and then the proposed legislation to see how they truly compare and if truly we could meet the eligibility requirements. Unfortunately for us in this measure, we still feel that the bill does not fully meet the comprehensive requirements of Race to the Top. The areas that we think are lacking and the reason we cannot support the bill is, number one, there's a lack of a state funding plan. We feel that the legislature needs to be involved and play a role in ensuring that the way that these funds are distributed are clearly your goals and your priorities. We do not believe it should be left into a plan submitted to the federal government without clearly your stamp of approval. We support a greater level of those funds going to the local level. We support the concept of an 80-20 split or a 90-10. We truly, truly think that these funds should go to local districts and struggling schools first, and less should go to the bureaucracy here in Sacramento. Our second concern with the bill is there's no reference to support for teachers and principals, for professional development, for mentoring, for coaching, particularly those teachers and those principals in the struggling schools. We think that's absolutely critical in any measure that goes forward to the federal government. The proposed section on standards and assessment review, we actually feel that this is too weak for eligibility for Race to the Top. It's 70 points of the full plan, and unfortunately, the only reference in here is to the state board having a role in adding to our current standards rather than reflecting on the full Common Core. We believe for California, we need an independent, objective advisory body comprised of content experts to look at math and reading language arts standards to ensure that they truly meet what we want to deliver to all students. We don't think it should be left just to an appointed body. In regards to assessments, there's no language in the bill that relates to an assessment review, yet our own STAR system is going to sunset in July 2011. We think without that legal structure, we lose points in California. And then finally, on charter quality, while we know there's differing opinions about what those priorities should be, we do believe in parity for academic achievement for all students in both non-charter and charter. And we feel that the bill, by just studying the aspects of charter quality, will not make us competitive. It is 55 points, and if we only have a study, we feel we won't remain competitive. Finally, we think that the bill should have a sunset so we can truly evaluate, if this bill goes forward, its effectiveness. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Patricia Rucker. I represent the California Teachers Association. From the moment that the Race to the Top regulations were introduced, CTA has urged the state of California to be wise and to slow down the process and the decisions that would be made to make any work or effort toward making an application for Race to the Top. For that reason, CTA took a long time before they decided to take a position on this bill, and we decided to oppose the bill for a number of reasons. In looking at the race of the top criteria, it's clear that the bill does not help California create a plan. It's in fact an incomplete template. Beyond that, it fails to implement significant requirements that are mandates in the federal race to the top priorities. More importantly, it is very urgent that the state of California look at its current reform plans, its current reform initiatives, and be clear that we need to align not only our own personal initiatives and goals to a reform plan, but to understand the role that the federal government is offering to the state to be comprehensive but also coherent in understanding that there's a linkage between the work that we have done and understanding what has worked and why, and the work that needs to be done. Having an annual goal or having even a set of goals and targets to get us there will not be accomplished by this bill. We will continue to work with Senator Romero. She has been a very patient mentor for me. She has been very clear in talking with us and all the conversations we've had. So we've had very, very good conversations. And she knows this. But we're very disappointed that there's not more work that could have been done with this bill.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Liz Guillen with Public Advocates. Early on, we took a position of support because we did support the concept, but now that the final regulations are out and we've had the opportunity to look at what's before us, we don't believe that this measure is as comprehensive as it should be to really make us competitive. We do believe that there should be greater accountability for charter schools and that it's not appropriate to remove the cap on charters without requiring the same academic standards. This is taxpayer money that charter schools are using, and our families should not be paying for their kids to be in laboratories experimented upon. There should be some willingness on the part of charter schools to say, okay, the experiment is over. In terms of the open enrollment piece, we had opposed the districts of choice bill that Senator Romero had gotten through the last session. And the reason we opposed it was for the same, was because there weren't enough safeguards, especially for poor families, families of color, and immigrant families. And that lack is still, that is still lacking in this measure. And while we're throwing around civil rights terms, I would characterize that as separate and unequal choice. And I think that we should be clear that right now NCLB already offers choice for these same schools. And if we're going to improve upon that, let's really do that and include the safeguards that we had asked for and that the sponsors of the choice bill said, yeah, yeah, those are great ideas, but this isn't the right bill for. On the final point, or two points, the blanket waivers for the districts that signed the MOUs is clearly exceeding the requirements of the race to the top. There's no need for us to take that step. And the lack of emphasis in the bill on the distribution of teachers, the most important resource that students have, and supporting the development, their professional development, or other strategies to ensure equitable distribution, is a concern for us. We assume that we will continue to share these concerns with the senator and the sponsors of the bill, and we hope that they can be addressed in what ultimately comes out of the legislature. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair and the committee. I'm Gary Ravani. I'm president of the Early Childhood K-12 Council with the California Federation of Teachers. CFT has an opposed position on SB X51. CFT understands that the legislature feels there are good reasons to pursue the extra educational funding available in Race to the Top. However, please note that all reform requires change, but not all change is reform. CFT also believes that the passage of SB 19 has satisfied the eligibility requirements of Race to the Top for data collection and use. SB X51 unnecessarily embellishes this aspect by potentially obliterating the limits of linking data with any other data in a manner that may have no educational value but could surely have unforeseen consequences. CFT has serious reservations about the centralization of this data collected and the potential for abuse. SB 5X1 provides unnecessarily for additional authority for the Commission on Teacher Credentialing to establish more alternative routes to educator preparation. CFT knows that CTC already has numerous alternative pathways for teacher credentialing in place. CFT believes that the current cap on charter schools fits the requirements of Race to the Top. Let me note, CFT already represents a number of different charter schools. We are not hostile to charter schools. As a union president, which I was for 20 years, I helped write a charter. So I understand charters. I have worked with charters. That being said, the real question on charter schools is not quantity, it's quality. Recent research conducted by Stanford University as well as the National Center for Educational Statistics under the U.S. Department of Education indicate that in the majority of cases, charter school students do know better and frequently do worse than students in regular public schools. Charter schools need to be held accountable for the claims they make to students, parents, and the state. CFT believes that the provisions in SB X51 for open enrollment failed to improve the options already available to parents in this state as well as federal law. It would add to the burden and confusion of schools with no promise of educational improvement. In the context of current cuts to school transportation, it creates a bias towards parents who have the means to transport their students outside their home geographic area. SB X51 grants unilateral authority to the State Board of Education to amend current state content standards. Now, CFT supports the timely revision of the standards, and there is no current authorization for updating those standards. For example, current standards don't recognize the events of 9/11. They still identify Pluto as a planet. My favorite, after many years of teaching 7th grade world history, and I believe this is standard 9.6, is students will learn St. Thomas Aquinas' synthesis of classical humanism and Christian theology. This is for 13-year-olds. The standards do need revision, but only with the broad participation of classroom practitioners. The CFT urges a vote of no on SB X51. Thank you.
Madam Chair, members, again, Fred Jones representing the California Business Education Association, and Senator Romero, we do not have an official position on your bill, but the concern we have, and you've been here all day, so you've probably heard it, is the lack of inclusion of career technical education in holding districts accountable for Racing the Top. So that's our concern we'd like to see addressed.
And thank you. Next witness.
Martha Zaragoza Diaz, representing the California's Together Coalition, and we have an oppose unless amended position on the bill. I don't want to repeat some of the other reasons why the other organizations were opposing the bill. I'd just like to make 3 points. One, with regard to the parent trigger language that's in the bill, an LEA can overturn that parent's request if they send a written notice to the state superintendent and the school board. I mean, the State Board of Education stating that they have a more promising approach. All they need to do is send a written notification. We believe that an amendment is in order for them to consider at least also sending that written notice to the parents who requested. That's another arrangement. So that's one. The other concern that I have is with regards to the core standards. There is no process in the bill with regards to allowing other stakeholders or the public to even take a look at what's being considered in terms of inclusion in the core standards, and also the need to include addressing the English language development standards and make those a part of the core standards. Lastly, with regards to the assessment piece, we believe that there may be some unintended consequences with regards to teachers who are teaching English learners if we don't start addressing the issue of developing a valid, reliable, and comparable assessment for English learners. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Good afternoon. Barrett Snyder on behalf of the Franklin McKinley School District. We have an ongoing issue with the lack of specifying how the transportation for the open enrollment is provided. The bill is silent on how we pay for transporting students outside of the district. This is particularly a concern for poor kids who otherwise may not be able to participate. The concern is that over time, if you don't provide funding for transportation, that you literally lock the poorest kids in the lowest performing schools, and there's no option for them to utilize it. So we're for open enrollment so long as we can find a way to pay for it for poor kids. Also want to reiterate points been made, but just briefly, there are options in law, in the federal law, that allow kids attending poor students attending low performing schools to transfer to another school. That's existing law, and there's money to do that. So thank you.
Where is the Franklin McKinley School District located?
San Jose.
Thank you. Yeah. Next witness?
Erica Hoff.
Mike?
Erica Hoffman, on behalf of the California School Boards Association. I know that your time has now definitely run short, but I would like to say that we are in opposition to this measure for many of the reasons already mentioned. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness?
Sandra Morales, on behalf of Pomona Unified, in opposition of this bill.
Thank you.
Harold Boyd, United Teachers, Los Angeles. We oppose the bill. We agree with everything the speakers have said, but I think the bottom line is that this is about money. Nobody's saying it, but it is about money. It's one-year money. We're already $21 billion down for next year. Now we're going to go deeper. We oppose the bill.
Thank you. Next witness.
Steve Henderson, California School Employees Association. We oppose the bill for many of the reasons that you've heard earlier.
Thank you. Next witness.
Madam Chair and members, Caitlin Vega for the California Labor Federation, also here in opposition for the reasons stated.
Thank you.
Madam Chair, member Stephanie Roberson, on behalf of the California Nurses Association, regretfully in opposition. Thank you.
Thank you. Next witness.
Roberta Ferger, PICO, California. We don't have a formal position on the bill. I do want to speak to the parent trigger provision. We think we are in support of the effort to have parents be meaningful participants in the turnaround process, and have spoken repeatedly to that. We think these measures could be strengthened by making sure that parents are informed participants in the process. So we would encourage the senator to look to amendments that would provide for parent meetings on the school site, parent notification through letters, and meaningful ways in which to ensure that the parents are really taking an active role, evaluating options, and putting forth the best strategy for their children. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other witnesses in opposition? Seeing none. Questions from members? Ms. Buchanan. Mr. Amiano next.
Yeah, I have a question, sort of both a comment and a question about the parent trigger. Before I was elected to school board, we had a system where parents developed curriculum, and it was great, except that it sat on the shelf and looked. And if someone pulled out the binder, it looked good, but it wasn't being implemented in the classroom. So we went to a system that was collaborative, where both parents and teachers worked together to develop curriculum, and then we really started to make changes. So I, you know, with my roots being a PTA, feel very strongly about parent involvement in schools. But your trigger is basically solely with parents. I mean, when we're talking about choosing an option, is there a reason not to have a collaborative process where you're involving both parents and teachers and administrators?
As I indicated, I'm going to have the undersecretary probably respond to most of the questions you have on the specifics of the bill.
Thank you. I think the reason that the parent is so important is because they are, of course, child's first teacher, and they are the ones who can make the best decision about their own children's education. And the parent voice is important because the parent petition idea really is to help parents get their local board to look at that low performing or failing school when they might not otherwise. Because many of these schools have been failing for so long, parents have probably asked, but nothing has happened. So this formalizes the process so that parents can present a petition in a democratic process to their local governing board. Of course, everyone will be involved at that hearing. All of the groups that you mentioned will have a voice.
Well, maybe I'm a little confused then, because certainly we know 50% of the parents, 50% of the teachers, you can have a form a charter school. Certainly, I'm definitely in favor of parents being able to petition their local school board for change. I thought I read in the bill where once a school was in program improvement, 50% of the parents could demand a certain option be chosen. And if you're going to choose that option, it seems to me it would make sense to involve other stakeholders in the process. So I want to talk specifically about once a program is in program, once a school is in program improvement and has to select one of the four options.
I think that it, you know, if that's the way the bill reads, that's certainly not the intent. The intent is for the parent groups to sign, if they get enough signatures, to present it to the local governing board, who is then required to choose from one of those same options that they would be required to choose from if they were one of the bottom 5%. So if there's something technical, we will obviously want to fix the language.
Then I have one other specific question and some general ones I'd like you to address. Another deals with the blanket waiver for districts signing the MOU. Certainly if a district becomes a charter school, I mean, one of the ideas behind charters is to free the charter school from ed code and regulation to give it more flexibility to make the decisions that are best for, you know, student achievement in that school. If every school district in this state signed an MOU, would that mean we'd not have ed code anymore because we would be giving them all blanket waivers?
That's not the idea. Actually, charter schools are required to follow most of the education code. So this would only give schools that are participating in Race to the Top the same flexibility as charter schools. Charter schools are not freed of every ed code provision,
provisions. And then lastly, I'm sure you've read the analysis, but on pages 9 and 10, there are a number of items that they list in terms of how the bill is deficient or concerns that they have. So could you just generally address those just for our own information?
I don't have the analysis in front of me, but I think that first I want to say that we took a fundamentally different approach than the assembly bill. And I don't mean that in a policy manner, just in terms of the structure. Our reading of Race to the Top guidelines, both the draft and the final, as well as our meetings that we've attended with the U.S. Department of Education staff, have led us to the conclusion that the federal department is serious when they say that they want this to be developed at the local level in the local communities. And so when we were working on this bill with Senator Romero, we realized that what we needed to do for Race at the Top was put as few requirements in the bill as possible, only those requirements that are needed to authorize something that we wanted to be part of the state plan. Race to the Top is a voluntary program. So for instance, school principal and school teacher evaluations in state law are required to be either every other year or every 3 years respectively. Race to the Top requires evaluations every year, but we don't need to change state law to have annual evaluations for everyone. We only need to have in our MOU and state plan that participating LEAs will commit to doing annual evaluations. So this is, in effect, a way to let each LEA, their local bargaining units, and their employees commit to those changes that will transform their education. So many of the deficiencies that are noted are simply a difference in approach. All of the details regarding low-performing schools, et cetera, are all going to be in the state plan. What we've done in our bill is simply cross-reference the definitions in Race to the Top for simplicity. We've found in the past that sometimes when we try to restate federal law, we mess it up and then we're not in compliance. So we thought it was cleaner to simply reference the federal guidelines themselves. So I think that addresses a great many of the suggestions. In terms of the standards and assessments, we in this bill do require that the state board adopt the Common Core standards at each grade level. I think there was someone earlier who stated that it did not require that. It very clearly requires that the state board adopt the Common Core at every grade level, but then further requires that the board add standards at each grade level to ensure that California does not lower its academic rigor. This is extremely important and something that we heard statewide. We've gone up and down the state and met with hundreds of people, and I know that Senator Romero has done the same, and this is the one thing we heard over and over: don't lower our standards. And so we have done that. We've met the requirements of Race to the Top by adopting, but also met the requirement to maintain our standards by saying add just enough to maintain the rigor at each grade level. We also, I think, have amendments to address the issue of the assessment timelines, the framework timelines, et cetera. So I think those are part of the draft amendments that the senator passed out earlier.
If I may, this is Ben Austin with the Parent Revolution. If I may very briefly answer the collaboration issue around the parent trigger. It goes without saying that you simply cannot have a great school without great teachers, great principals, and parents collaborating with them. So it is absolutely impossible to transform a school without the type of collaboration that Ms. Buchanan has referenced. All we are talking about with the parent trigger is giving parents the power to trigger that process. We're working with parents all across Los Angeles right now who are trapped within the attendance boundaries of systemically failing schools. They have no power to change things. And it is a horrible feeling to know that your child has to go to this school that is not serving them. All we're saying is parents and parents alone should be able to trigger that process. After that process is triggered, parents must work collaboratively with the staff, with the teachers, with the principals, and with the school's leadership.
I think another
issue. Does that address your questions?
My concern with the trigger is in terms of which alternative is chosen for the persistently low performing schools and the collaboration you have there. Let me just finish my time by saying that there are parts of both bills that I like and parts of both bills that I don't like. And my hope, regardless of how we go forward today, is that we'll sit down and we'll work together. Because what's really clear to me in listening to everyone who's come to testify is that having schools that continually perform at very low rates, that have very low high school graduation rates, and that are on your list of schools that you rolled out there, is just not acceptable to anybody. And we can't continue to have generations of children go through these schools and have the rhetoric of change without making a commitment to really change. And I personally believe if we're going to do that, we have to have parent involvement. But I also believe, as you said, we have to be willing to make an investment in having leaders at our schools who are trained and in service and provide the proper support. We have to make the investment in recruiting and retaining the very best teachers we can, and in providing the in-service and training and giving them time to share best practices. We have to make the investment in having a data system that we can use that gives us meaningful information and helps us direct that change. So, you know, I don't know. Ultimately, it's too bad we have the timeline we do. I think the federal government's making a big mistake in not authorizing ESEA before it's putting out the Race to the Top guidelines, because that would make this process much easier for all of us. You know, I believe we have to move forward as a state, and I would hope that all of us can work together to have the final bill that's adopted and signed by the governor, one that all of us can support and embrace, so the children in California are the real winners. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Buchanan. Mr. Amiano.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Senator, for all your hard work and your energetic work as well. And as an aside, congratulations on getting the governor's signature on 680. At least you didn't get the acrostic veto that I got, so I'm very impressed by that and your accomplishments. I need a clarification. Because the race, the lowest achievement, achieving schools have been brought up persistently. I was wondering how many schools, but also in the bill itself, what has been stated here is that the lowest achieving schools must implement one of the Race to the Top models, but the bill ties the requirement to the No Child Left Behind requirement. So maybe we could just get an elaboration of that. Just curious.
Just to note that we do, of course, have many NCLB requirements in state law, and we can't remove them until ESEA is reauthorized. Having said that, the definition that is in this bill, it specifically cross-references the Race to the Top guidelines, and the Race to the Top guidelines, as well as the school improvement guidelines, are linked together. And the definition is those schools who have not achieved any growth for some number of years on the state test, schools that are in program improvement, and schools that would be in Title I but are not because they're not being funded. Additionally, it includes high schools with a 60% dropout rate. So all of those schools are included in the definition in SB 1. Our best estimate at the moment is that the lowest 5% of the persistently low-performing schools using the federal definitions is around 200.
Okay. Except, you know, in fairness, it's still a bit confusing, but I do appreciate your explanation. And just one quickie, in terms of the district of choice, will there be any consequences in terms of discrimination, et cetera, because it doesn't seem that this bill has the safeguards that the senator put into 680.
I think it includes all of the same language. It includes the language that says you can't reduce the racial diversity. That's the standard language that's in every program in the education code that deals with movement of students, and that is included.
Assemblyman Amiano, on page 16, I think it's what, lines
16 to 23.
Lines 16 through 23, that addresses that question there.
All right. I appreciate that. Thank you.
We believe it excludes religion, income, and sexual orientation in the language. There's no protection for those variables.
We have to recalibrate the boilerplate language then, if that's the case, or update it.
Are you done, Mr. Amiano?
Yes.
Thank you. Mr. Nistande.
Thank you. There's some well-meaning folks on the other side that oppose this. I understand that, and I wish we could lift up the teacher profession to a higher focus in our society and more appreciation and pay them more. But I get the feeling, though, listening to both sides of the argument, that one side, people oppose, is really somewhat defending the status quo, and the other side is screaming out for change. And the question on the trigger, the parent trigger, I don't get the angst on that, because if you get 50% of the parents asking for change, that's a very good thing. And whatever they do, I really don't care. If you got 50% of the parents that fired up, good things are going to happen. I mean, you don't even get close to that right now in these schools. To get that kind of parental involvement, that means things are very bad. So I'd be willing to invest more in education, but if it's asking to put money into the same institutions that have failed over and over again, that would be a huge mistake. So if we're going to make real change, I get it. It can be uncomfortable, but that's the way you open the door to long-term change, to increase funding and those type of things. You can't do it in the current system. So thank you for your bill, but I want to ask you, did you get a chance to read the spreadsheet from that the CTA put out? It's very detailed. They took some time into analyzing the two bills. Did you get a chance to look at that? And do you have any comments on?
We continue to look at all the letters of support and opposition, as we've indicated. We have, and even again, too, as the CTA representative indicated, as when there have been some conversations, we look forward to continuing conversations, and that's where we stand. Absolutely. I know that whether somebody opposes or supports the bill, we know there's been a lot of deliberation and thought, and we appreciate that. There are some philosophical differences that are just there. There are some areas we believe they're technical issues that we can address readily. There are others that have indicated we don't have to put everything back into a bill. There's others that we argue this belongs in the plan or the MOU. It doesn't belong in statute. But our point here, and like I indicated, it's been a long road. We are grateful that we're here today having the hearing, is there's still a long road ahead of us. And that long road is really more symbolic than anything, because in reality, our time frame is short. So, yes, we read, yes, we review, we continue to keep the door open and look forward to moving forward to continue to have the conversations to finalize and have the strongest enabling legislation to produce the strongest plan possible for California.
Well, thank you, and I just want to thank all of the different parent groups that showed up. You could just tell there's real desperation in what they say and a real desire for something different. So thank all of them for showing up.
Thank you, Mr. Nistande. Mr. Solorio.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do want to thank the Senator for being patient. It's been a long day. We've heard a lot of good testimony on all these bills. I think you have some very targeted, solid initiatives in your bill that I really do like. And, you know, particularly at our struggling schools, we don't need, you know, minor, modest changes. We need, you know, some pretty major reforms, and I think you have several in your bill. A couple in particular that I really like are the STEM program for having alternative ways for engineers and others with technical background to get a credential that's much needed in our state and in this country. So I really like that. I also like the parent trigger. I do think maybe a little bit more thought needs to be given to talking about what shortcomings are there at the school. Are they in the, you know, fiscal, financial management? Is it about academic performance? Right now it's pretty open-ended, and it could be somebody doesn't like the athletic performance of the basketball team, and I don't think that's the intent. So maybe a few qualifiers there would be important. I'd like to see, as we move forward on this discussion about race to the top, that we, you know, pick some of the best reforms that we have in all these bills. You know, that there's no reason, I think, why we should just pick one bill or one reform. I'd like to ask, you know, you and you know, Chairman Bradley to continue to work together, as well as with leadership in both houses, to have all the best ideas, let them flow to the top, and let's figure out a way that we could be successful in a bicameral fashion and have ultimately the best application, you know, before our president. So I really commend you on your work, and I think you have some real jewels in your bill that can be polished a little bit, that can be part of a successful application. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Solorio. Mr. Ng.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank you to the author of SB1 for all your work, and I just had a couple of questions. I don't know, this is kind of like when I went to school and I read it and I heard it and I read it and I heard it, but I'm still trying to understand it. So I guess starting off at 10 o'clock and now it's 3:30, I guess it's about time for me to understand it. So on the parent trigger, it's my understanding that AB8 defines persistently low-achieving schools. And if they meet that threshold, then they must implement one out of the four models, the transformational model, turnaround model, restart model, and school closure model. Now, my question is, does SB1, how does that differ? Because what I heard earlier from the very effective advocate sitting to the right of the author was that only after the 50% petition had been reached, then and only then would one of those four be chosen. So my question is, how is that an improvement if under AB8 it's mandatory and it's only optional under SB1 if and only if the 50% threshold is reached? That's my first question.
So there's two parts to the persistently low achieving schools section. One part is that if you're identified as one of the lowest 5% of the persistently low achieving schools, you must do one of the four options. In addition, we've included the parent petition, the parent trigger, so that if you have a school who is in program improvement, that is one of the other 571 schools, but they're not one of the lowest 5%, the parents can request that their local school board do one of the four options. And the final decision is completely up to the local school board. So it's not as though the parents are saying, this is what we want, and it happens. There's a hearing, and there's collaboration, and the local school board will make the final decision.
Okay. Thank you for that clarification. And my second question relates to the issue of the eligibility or actual receipt of the stimulus funds, of the RTTT funds. And the question is this. Under which of these bills, let me backtrack, strike that. It's been stated on either side that one of these bills maximizes the eligibility for the Race to the Top funds. And my question is, under, is it the, my understanding that the author is stating that under SB 1, it maximizes the eligibility over AB 8, or that in reality, that per se, as drafted with amendments that are before us, categorically SB 1 will result in more eligibility funds. And my question is, how can there be any assertion over funding when there's a threshold for the MOUs with the school districts that, as we know, we, this time we don't know which ones will sign the MOUs. And so it relates to that sub-question.
You're absolutely correct. I think there's two parts to your question. So the first part is the last part of your question.
Right. In other words, can you even state that?
Right. The number of LEAs participating, the number of LEAs that sign an MOU will definitely have an effect on the amount of funding for which California is eligible. We are eligible for, under their guidelines, we're eligible for $700 million. We could ask for more, but I really doubt that they would give us more, having put out their guidelines. But it's, if we get one school district, I don't think we would be able to justify $700 million. If we get 500 school districts, that's a different matter. So somewhere in between 1 and 500, you know, we're really hoping. In fact, if we could get all 1,500 LEAs, that would be really our ideal. But you know, that probably won't happen. We recognize that. I think what we spoke to in relation to AB 8 with respect to the funding distribution is that Race to the Top has very specific criteria on how the state is required to distribute the funds. So, for instance, 50% must go to LEAs that have Title I students, and it has to go in the proportion of their Title I. So if one LEA gets 2% of all the LEAs that are participating in Race to the Top, if their proportional share is 2%, then that's what they get of that 50%. The other 50% we need to use for school districts who are participating that are not Title I eligible. We've had a number of high-performing LEAs that have asked us if they can participate, because there's something in Race to the Top for everyone, whether we're talking about differences in using formative assessments, using real-time data in the classroom, changing how we evaluate principals and teachers collaboratively with the collective bargaining units, of course. All of those reforms are good for all students and all schools, not just low-performing schools. And there's also some funding that needs to be reserved for things like developing those formative assessments, developing the tools that will help the LEAs actually do this hard work. So by focusing all of the dollars on, or most of the dollars on, low-performing schools, it doesn't allow any ability to help those districts who are not low-performing or who are not Title I eligible.
So my question is that if someone says that this bill will categorically result in more federal stimulus money versus that bill, that's an unfair statement, because there are many conditions that have to be met and many assumptions that would be made in terms of one bill over another. Is that true or not true?
I haven't heard anyone say that, but I think it would be very difficult to say, other than I haven't seen the amendments to AB 8, but as we read AB 8, there are many parts of it, again, that are not consistent, and so thus could significantly affect our eligibility for any funding. So it's not an issue of how much funding, it's are we consistent or not consistent.
Okay. Well, finally, I just have sat here for 3 years, and I just want to make one observation that, and it has to do, it started with Mr. Cotto's presentation, as well, and I think it was stated by Ms. Arambula, that the Asian Pacific Islander community is possibly included many times in many of these underperforming schools. I was an at-risk child, probably in a very low-performing school, not destined to even graduate from high school. And I think we have to be careful when we present our data in such a way that the perception sometimes is that the Asian American community has overperformed at the expense of other communities. And I say that because in our very historic research on how healthcare data is presented, we found that the Asian Pacific Islander community, which is 54 subcategories is aggregated many times into two or three. Mm-hmm. We don't even have a census that lists our categories. And so, therefore, it's very possible that many of the Cambodians, the Vietnamese, the Laotians, the Hmong, and Pacific Islander communities, the Samoans, the Tongans, the Hawaiians, I know are in these very, very low-performing schools. So I intend to ask for detailed research that we, so that we can then attempt to address the myth of the model minority, that the Asia-Pacific Islanders somehow are in the highest performing achieving schools, and that they don't have counterparts in the African-American, Latino, and other disadvantaged communities. I think that's absolutely not true. And I intend to make sure that we have the data so that we don't make those well-intended but often misplaced assumptions.
If I could just add, Mr. Ng, part of Race to the Top and part of the requirements that are included in the State Fiscal Stabilization Fund, the longitudinal data, will help us gather exactly that data. That is what has been missing in the education system for a long time, and that's really one of the huge benefits of this new set of grants.
Thank you. So long as the disaggregated categories are allowed to exist, but if you ask a Pacific Islander to say, are they Japanese, Chinese, or Korean, it's not going to, they're not going to show up. And many Filipinos, for example, have Latino name, Hispanic names. So we need to make sure that, that those studies, when they do occur, are categorized in a statistically justifiable but equitable manner.
And if I can make a quick statement about that, because I think you made an important point. When we organized the rally that Senator Romero referred to on August 25th to pass the public school choice resolution in Los Angeles and brought out 3,000 parents to demand change, those parents spanned racial, ethnic, socioeconomic, and geographic boundaries, because parents, no matter where you live and what you look like, you all want the same thing. And I think that that is another reason why the parent trigger is so critical, because it is a way to unite parents, unite communities, rather than divide them. And I think the point you make is so important, that we can't focus just on the worst of the worst of the worst. This is about all of us coming together in this moment. So thank you.
Mr. Ng, are you finished with your
questions?
I've
done. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Mr. Arambula.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd like to address some of the concerns raised by the opposition, Senator. By way of background, several years ago, I took a little different approach to deal with that long list of failing schools that you presented. And my focus was not on the individual schools, but on the districts that serve those schools, because oftentimes the problems at individual schools are systemic in terms of personnel policies or contractual agreements or housing or, you know, decisions that were made by the district. My point is that I tried a pilot district in the two counties that I represent for the same types of schools and districts. And those, many of the same groups that are in opposition to your bill opposed my bill and killed it. And one of the individuals said to me, well, Juan, you have to understand, if your approach works, other people might like to try it too. Now, why do I support this bill? I really applaud President Obama for having raised this. We would not be having this discussion if it were not for the president's focus on making major structural changes in our public educational system. I support your bill for a couple of reasons. You know, as someone who's interested in economic development and having chaired the Jobs Committee for a number of years, I know that the employer community is desperate for a qualified workforce. And as we look at the changes in our economy going forward, it's clear we're going to have better trained workers, both with university as well as with career technical education backgrounds. And I also, yesterday afternoon, chaired a meeting, a hearing dealing with the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation because of the severe cuts that have been made in the rehabilitation components of CDCR. And we heard time and time again about the educational level of inmates, about how much they need to receive adult basic education, you know, just to prepare them to not recidivate again. You know, and we all know the cost of incarcerating inmates is about $50,000 a year, and we're not getting much out of that process. But it seems to me that from an economic perspective, from a cost avoidance perspective, we need to do something to drastically improve our schools. So that's one reason. The second reason is more personal. I have nieces and nephews who have gone to school or will be going to school in Paramount, which I think is probably on your list. I have a brother who scrimped and saved and did without so that he could send his kids to private school in Richmond. And we all know the shape. I mean, just recently there was a gang rape of a 15-year-old. And, you know, many times these schools are not the kind of schools that we want our children to go to, but we don't have a choice. So it really comes down to choice. Parents, I think, do have choices if you have money. Because if you have money, you can buy a home in a good district. You can move away from the gang problems, from all of the other problems that afflict many of our schools. But parents without money, they're stuck. They're trapped. They have no choice. They have no ability to petition. And so, you know, when someone said, well, we would support the choice if we could fund transportation, you know, parents are willing to find a way to pay for parochial school, are willing to find a way to pay for the transportation if they're given a choice. So I look at your bill, and I see that it has the same opposition to my approach. I see that the support for doing something to score points on the race to the top, it's really nitpicking. I think what we need to do is, as you have done, take a bold approach and to say, what can we do to jumpstart this system? What can we do to force change by giving people who are most affected the ability to do something about it? Because it's not going to happen with just the folks that have been operating the system. The status quo is not going to change on its own initiative and, in fact, will resist change at every possible step. So I am frustrated beyond description. I am somebody who is very supportive of public education. But my patience has limits, I think, as yours does. And if we don't make these kinds of changes, I fear for our public educational system because people will take action in one form or another and perhaps lead to another attempt at vouchers or something even more radical. So if we want to preserve the public educational system, I think we need to support your bill, and I certainly do.
Thank you, Mr. Arambula. Mr. Garrick.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Good afternoon. Welcome, Senator. I wanted to say first that I'm pleased to be a co-author of your bill. Second, I appreciate the approach that you've taken as it relates to empowering parents with some of the options like the triggers that have been spoken about, the open enrollment and other items. I would encourage you, I presented a proposed amendment as your bill moves forward, that you look at the career technical education aspects. Those are very important. As I addressed earlier in my comments relative to the number of individuals that are graduating from high school and those that go on to four-year or even two-year institutions and those that are find themselves out in the workforce and have not the skills to compete or to earn the salary that they need to. So the career technical education aspect is very important to me, and I would like to share some of that language with you for your bill to be considered incorporating it in to the data collection and the other aspects that my amendments address. Some of them, coincidentally, are the exact verbiage taken from Assemblyman Nunez's AB 400, which passed out of our House last year, and go over some of what I believe are basic requirements to help bring career technical education to the level of recognition, emphasis, and allow it to be both funded appropriately and to be measured appropriately. And thank you. And any comments you'd like to make along those lines would be appreciated.
Let me just say thank you very much for your leadership in being one of the earliest co-authors on the measure. And let me also just do a point of clarification at this point. I know a lot of people are saying this is my bill. Actually, this is a bipartisan bill, and I do want to acknowledge the joint authors on this bill. It includes, of course, Senator Huff, Senator Ahlquist, Senator Weiland. This was an effort that we did deliberately to make sure that this was about all of us, you know, Republicans, Democrats in the Senate, and hopefully Republicans, Democrats, and independents here in the Assembly. This is one that we truly believe is nonpartisan, and we appreciate the co-authorship. We did, of course, want to highlight and emphasize science, technology, engineering, mathematics, of course, and that's why we included this as we moved forward. We would look forward to continuing to address the amendments that you've raised and see what we can do to put this into the language as we go on.
Mr. Garrick, Mr. Gaines.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Senator Romero, thank you for bringing this legislation forward. And I guess a concern that I have, I also address with Assembly Member Brownlee, had to do with career tech and the fact that I'm not quite clear as to why that's missing, because it seems to me to be such a key component in terms of the paths that we provide for children in our educational system. So I'll just throw that out there. But in general, I like very much your legislation that you've brought forward. I really appreciated the comments by Alice Huffman with the NAACP. In terms of, you know, the time to act is now. And if you take a look at what's happening across America today and some of the challenges that we've had even in our economy, take a look at General Motors. And what happened with General Motors? I think General Motors tried to evolve into a more effective corporate entity, and it didn't do it fast enough. It got run over. It went bankrupt. The government stepped in. They're trying to rehabilitate it. They're trying to revolutionize it. You had the CEO, Henderson, was just booted out because he wasn't acting quickly enough. I think we have the same pressures on this legislative body. When we look at what's happening with the Bay Area Study Group, California Forward, that is looking to reform government and how we provide services, and the challenges that we've had with our budget and the way we provide services in the state of California. We need to take a look, I think, at more of a revolutionary approach versus an evolutionary approach. And I think basically what you're doing encompasses that. The ability to empower parents through the process, I think, is critical. So. Thank you for bringing that forward, and I'm in support.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Gaines. Any other questions from members? I know I have a few. Thank you, Senator, for your leadership around this issue. There are a couple of areas of concern that I have with the bill that I just wanted to highlight. One certainly is, which is probably, I understand now is a big centerpiece of your bill, is the choice issue. And this is the problem. I'm not against choice, absolutely. And but we, No Child Left Behind already authorizes choice. Your bill, which was a major bill for the legislature this past session in terms of districts of choice, which really expanded, assuming that school districts elected to be districts of choice, but it expanded it, statewide. I mean, people have that option to create that process if they want to. So, I think choice, there's a lot of choice, in that area. And, one of the things that, and we debated here in this chamber around your bill was the safeguards around districts of choice in the collection of data. And I'm concerned, and I think the undersecretary talked about the importance of data. I'm concerned that if we moved forward with something like this, that there's really no way of sort of collecting the data to make sure that, open enrollment or, universal choice is going to be part of the solution. And we want to make sure that, we're zooming in on the achievement gap and giving kids the right access and equity. That's a concern for me around the choice piece. The other area is persistently lowest performing schools. The way this is written, I think the way your bill is written, it is possible, this scenario could be very possible, that school districts that sign up to participate in this race to the top, that sign an MOU, it is possible that the way the bill is written, I believe, right now, or you don't address this issue, is that the districts that sign the MOU could not have any of the defined persistently low-performing schools. So, in other words, while there is, intervention models for the lowest performing school, these districts that are going to participate, of which we're going to have funding, there could be no funding. The persistently lowest performing schools could not have access to really any funding. I'm not saying that it would. I'm just saying that it's a possibility. And then there is nothing in. I don't see it, but in reading through the bill and reading through the analysis, there's nothing really about the addressing sort of the equitable distribution of teachers based on subject areas that are hard to fill, and also for schools that are hard to fill. And that is a concern for me. And finally, the last real concern is around this blanket waiver with the MOUs. And I know it was highlighted in the analysis, but it's my understanding that the Ed Code specifically, the exceptions that the Ed Code has for charter schools is around STIRS, attendance accounting, building standards. And so if we just had a blanket for these school districts that signed the MOU and they were had a blanket waiver on the Ed Code, as the analysis said, things could be eliminated. I'm not saying that they would, but they could. Criminal background checks for staff, mandatory pupil expulsions and suspensions, expulsion and appeals process, the Open Meetings Act and the Brown Act, checking pupil immunization records, and so forth. So that also is a very significant concern for me. I don't know if anybody has a response to any of that.
Let me just say overall, I know there's lots of concerns because I read them in the analysis. There's pages and pages of them. Things are possible. Are they probable? I think those are two different issues. It's also possible the world could end tomorrow, but I think we go forward. I think some of these issues that you've raised, some of them we can address and work out language. I'm the eternal optimist. I think we can. Some of these issues may just be philosophical. You raised the question of choice. We don't have data on it. I mean, to me, that's an issue. I think it's a value statement. I believe in choice. I believe in parents' responsibilities. But I also believe if we're giving responsibility to parents, we give them rights. So, and I don't know that we need to collect data on that, but if somebody wants to in the future run a bill, take a look at it, I'm all for it. I don't think that necessarily believes in this bill. To me, that's a value judgment about looking at the belief to empower parents to do the right thing for their kids, just like my mom did the right thing for me. I think on questions of looking at waivers, I mean, some of these are on a case-by-case basis that would have to be, that would, perhaps would be different for each LEA. On terms of the question of the equitable distribution of teachers, I think we're on the same page. In fact, I've run a bill in the previous session trying to get teachers, solid teachers in math and science and special education in the lowest percentile schools in California. We believe it doesn't have to be in the bill. Those are MOU issues. So I think that it's a question of, you know, maybe you've got the elephant, which part are we looking at? And so as long as we sort of have, these are the values that we want to be eligible, but we must be competitive. And to be competitive, it really means being bold, being different, being innovative, providing for options that they're not even new. I mean, we've talked about these ideas, you know, ad nauseum. Now the challenge, though, is let's start putting in cross-referencing, signing, figure out what goes in the bill, what goes in the MOU, what goes, what's already existent, but we just maybe have to highlight it. But having said that, let me turn to the undersecretary.
Well, let me just add on to my concern a little bit on the choice thing, because I forgot to point this out, is that in the No Child Left Behind requirements with the choice option, you know, one of the specifications about that is if students choose another, which, you know, they have the choice under No Child Left Behind, that they have to go to a higher performing school. So there's nothing, so we don't want kids to choose lower performing schools. We don't want them to go from bad to worse. We want them to go from bad to better. And also the, you know, and again, it might be a technical issue, you know, with the bill, but it's my understanding in terms of the definition for the persistently lowest performing schools, and these are really two issues, separate issues. But for the lowest performing schools, the turnaround models or the restructuring models is the No Child Left Behind. And I know in your introductory remarks you talked about, you know, some of the loopholes around some of the current, restructuring and so forth. And I think what you're referring to is the No Child, some of the choice within the No Child Left Behind that most school districts have chosen so far. But it's my understanding that's what you're referencing, that those are the choices that you're referencing for the lowest performing schools, that it is the No Child Left Behind restructuring elements.
I guess I'll say I could have missed it in reading it. If that is what it says for the bottom 5%, then it's a drafting error and we will fix it. The persistently low achieving schools in both school improvement grant and in Race to the Top have very specific four turnaround, and I believe that the bill cross references the Race to the Top guidelines, but you know, I could be mistaken. If I could just add on the choice issue relative to data, again, the data system that we will be implementing through the longitudinal data grant, the state fiscal stabilization fund requirements, which again is an eligibility criteria for Race to the Top, and through my, I need to also add there are some very important data requirements in this bill to allow us to complete those requirements. This bill includes the workforce data, it includes the language that we need in order to get agreement with all of our higher ed segments, but that longitudinal data system is what will tell you whether choice works, because you can follow students from school to school, and if their performance improves at the next school, you'll see whether it works or not. With respect to the persistently low achieving schools may not be those LEAs that sign up for Race to the Top. The school improvement grant is the primary source of funding for the bottom 5%. So the requirement to implement the four turnaround measures is a requirement for that bottom 5%, whether or not we do Race to the Top. It's something completely separate. It's a condition of Race to the Top that you have that as one of your state policies. What actually happens for LEAs who have one of these bottom 5%, if they sign up for Race to the Top, they're going to get two pots of money to deal with those lowest performing schools. So it's kind of a bonus for them if they do both. But they are going to have funding through the school improvement grant, so they will not be without funding if they don't choose to participate. On the equitable distribution of teachers, one of the reasons not to put it in statute just yet is that we believe that the Obama administration definition of highly effective teacher, which is the requirement in Race to the Top in terms of equitable distribution, is likely something that will be altered, or maybe not altered, but it's certainly going to be discussed as part of ESEA reauthorization. So again, we opted to include that in the MOU rather than in statute because we're trying to follow the guidelines and remembering that this is a voluntary program and we don't want to apply something statewide that is only for those LEAs that choose to participate. And again, with respect to the charters, I think the charter-like flexibility is something that the superintendents asked us for as something that would help them with their turnaround. These are only the districts or charters who already have that flexibility or county offices who are volunteering as part of Race to the Top. So they're going to be making commitments, very hard commitments, to work on all areas of the four assurances. And so I just have to believe that those are not the same LEAs that would be looking for a loophole. It's just too much hard work to get a loophole. They are only going to be asking for and using the flexibility that they need to do this hard work. That's my personal belief, and I hope that no one proves me wrong.
Okay, thank you very much. I think that concludes in terms of questions and comments. Senator, before we start, I'm sure there's going to be a motion on your bill, but before you start, I'd like to offer a suggestion for you to consider. And of course, with your concurrence, I'd like to offer the opportunity to go forward with the hearing on your bill, but not bring it to a vote today. And if over the next 24 hours, we're on this very tight timeline, but over the next 24 hours, if you're able to resolve some of the concerns that have been pointed out and work out a compromise on the measure, I've been given a note here that the speakers agree to reconvene this committee tomorrow to consider and vote on that compromise.
Let me thank you very much, Assemblywoman Chair Brownlee. For the conversations and for the engagement. I know that it's been a long day. You started early, as did we. I appreciate the offer, but I will respectfully decline that. We have worked too hard. You know, we have worked too long. We believe that it is not a time to stall. A race means we pick up the baton and we move with the words from a half century ago with all deliberate speed. I come to you today understanding we may have differences. Much of this, I believe, can be worked out. I believe it must be worked out. But I would be remiss if I were to say that I would come here and to say that all the work, all the belief, the challenge from President Obama, Secretary Duncan, the leadership, and I'm going to give credit to Governor Schwarzenegger, and I'm not going to do that many times, but on this issue I am going to give it to Governor Schwarzenegger. This is a nonpartisan issue. For Senator Huff, you know, for Senator Alquist, Senator Weiland, the vote of 21 senators who believe that we must move forward, the parents who came up today, the kids on this list, I ask for a vote today. I believe that we can and we will and we should do the right thing and move us forward. The controversy, I believe there are controversies largely in our minds. If we believe in empowerment, if we believe in parents, if we believe that status quo is not acceptable, if we are tired of building prison after prison and shortchanging our schools, then the time to stand up and to take a vote is today. And I will live with that vote. I will live with that vote. If it moves forward, I thank you, and I believe that we keep hope alive and we move forward. If it fails today, I will ask for reconsideration, and I will be tenacious in sitting down with you anyway, whether the bill goes out or whether the bill fails, and I hope the bill goes out. because I believe with so many other bills that have gone through this committee and my committee, we talk about moving things forward. You know, the arc of justice always bends forward. And so I heard that there was a motion. I appreciate that. I believe we can do it. I believe we should do it. I believe it would be a setback to all of us who believe in reform. Even if we disagree on some of the specifics in this bill, I believe it would be a setback for us to say we come here, we spend the entire day, and we walk away saying come back tomorrow. We have done that in this country, and we have done that in the state of California for too long. And I believe that with the winds of change blowing in Washington and here in Sacramento and across the state, the time for us to stand and deliver is today. It is right now, and I respectfully do ask for an aye vote.
Thank you, then. And there was a motion made by Mr. Nastande and second by Mr. Garrick. And I wish that, there was an opportunity to work out a compromise, but I hear your perspective on that. And I will ask. Before we take a vote, I want to thank you for your leadership on this important issue. I think we have a lot to agree upon. You know, I think we have some differences on how we get there. With that, I will just ask the secretary to call the roll.
Brownlee?
No.
Brownlee, no. Nastandi?
Aye.
Nastandi, aye. Amiano? Amiano, no. Arambula?
Aye.
Arambula, aye. Buchanan? Buchanan abstain. Fuentes? Chesbrough, not voting. Ng? Gaines?
Aye.
Gaines, aye. Garrick?
Aye.
Garrick, aye. Hall? Logue, aye. Bonnie Lowenthal?
No.
Lowenthal, no. Miller? Perez? Perez not voting. Solorio?
Aye.
Solorio, aye. Torlakson?
No.
Torlakson, no. 2, 4, 6 ayes.
6 ayes. We need 9 to get out of the committee. Are there
4 noes? And there's.
Is there enough votes that who are not here to vote? Yeah, I think, Senator, there are some members missing. There's 6 votes. We'll hold. I'll ask for the members to return to make a vote, and so we'll hold it open for the next 5 minutes or so to see if we can get the other members to come in and vote and determine the outcome.
And I will be patient and wait here for those next 5 minutes.
Great. So if we could ask the missing members of the committee who are not here to please come to the committee room and cast a vote. Thank you.
lights on or anything up here.
Okay.
Okay, we have waited over 5 minutes. For one time more, I will call Assemblymember Hall and Assemblymember Miller. Otherwise, all members have casted an aye, a no, or a not voting vote. So have the secretary call the absent members. The vote count is?
Call the absent members.
I just called the absent
six
members.
Six to five.
Francie needs to call.
Oh, I see. I need, the senator wants to know the vote right now.
Okay, well, it's six to five.
Okay. Right now, Senator, the vote is 6-5, and I will ask the secretary to call the two absent members for their vote.
Hall, Miller.
So they will be not voting, and that means your bill fails in the committee.
Madam Chair, let me just ask for a couple of points of clarification. Can you just tell me again, too, the number of members on the committee?
17.
There are 17 members on the committee.
Correct.
There are six, there were, because you've announced the vote already, there were six aye votes. There were five no votes, correct?
That's correct.
So,
and other members who have casted an abstention vote.
There are, so 11 votes truly have been counted aye or no. So we, there are 17 members. That means that members of the committee remain silent or abstain.
That is correct.
So essentially then I suppose I can conclude that the bill has been killed by silence. I just want to get the numbers correct. It's six ayes, five noes, and six members abstaining, remaining silent,
that's
or not
correct.
Showing up to committee.
That our microphone system has been not working all day. That is correct.
All right. I would respectfully ask for reconsideration.
I will grant reconsideration. I'm not sure that the time frame because, you know, but absolutely. I would most certainly would grant reconsideration. Thank you, Senator.
This hearing is adjourned.
Yes.
This hearing is adjourned. Thank you.